Yeah, so we were waiting for you all to come back, and we had kept a lot of work pending. So just to start with the case here, just introduce my team here. I'm Dr. Aftab, and this is Dr. Bikash Majumdar. He's a senior colleague of mine. We also have two more senior colleagues of mine, Dr. P.C. Mondal and Dr. Debashish Ghosh. And of course, not to mention the cath lab team led by Bala Subramaniam. And of course, there's the anesthetist, Dr. Debashish Panigrahi, and two nursing staffs, Mampi and Paulan. So this is a case that we thought we should discuss here. And can I see the first screen, please, the first slide? So this is a 71 years old lady. She's been a poorly controlled diabetic and a long-standing hypertensive. She's had an angioplasty to her circumflex and her OM done way back in 2008. Unfortunately, over the last 12 years, she has no data or no procedural details of the same. She used to have this angina on and off, what we normally now label as chronic coronary syndrome. But now, since the last few weeks or last few months, in fact, her symptoms had worsened. And she was now having crescendo angina and even rest episodes, which were interfering with her activities of daily life. Her labs were pretty normal. Her echo was normal. Troponin was negative. Renal function is normal. And she underwent an angiogram here with us 3 days back. Next slide. Yeah, so you can see that this is a left dominant circulation. And you can see the two stents there. Now, the ramus stent looks patent, but there's some mild instant restenosis. The circumflex stent shows a total ISR. And there's a critical lesion in the proximal part of the LAD. And it's a pretty calcified aorta. I don't want to understand. I mean, I don't know if you can see. There's a porcelain aorta there. You can see the outline of the aorta there in the angiogram. Next slide. And this is the other view also, showing that the LAD is pretty calcific in its entire course, right from the proximal and the mid part. And this is a left dominant circulation. Next. The circumflex, it's totally, there's an instant restenosis, and there are intracoronary collaterals filling from the same side, the homocollaterals which are there, which fill up almost till the distal part of the stent. So we had a heart team approach, and the surgical opinion was that they would be able to put a graft to the LAD, but because of the porcelain aorta, they said that they would not put in any venous grafts. And the patient, of course, refused CABG at her age, and she was absolutely unwilling to go for a procedure of a surgical procedure. We had to make sure that we at least did what was decided by the surgeon, that is to put in at least open up the LAD. But if we could also open up the circumflex, that would become an additional bonus for her. We were, of course, counseled against the long-term restenosis rates, and of course, the cost and the risks involved during the procedure also. So I'd like your comments upon how the approach that we would take for this case.
I think you've had a heart team going in already into decision making, and the patient with a porcelain aorta is not keen for a surgical revascularization. We would say imaging and physiology guided PCI would be an answer.
Right.
Although Anil, this is Ashish here, Srinivas. So
yeah,
you know, this is now left dominant system, porcelain aorta. We have to go back to what Kirti said in the previous presentation. You know, planning is everything. So before we get started, you need an ED. You first got to decide access, radial versus femoral. You got to decide EDP assessment, contralateral groin, if you want to make sure you have a 5-French sheath, and if you're planning to decide that you need support, Impella versus balloon pump. All of these things have to be planned before you walk into a case like this. Otherwise, this is a disaster waiting to happen. And I just feel like that has to be emphasized. And
sure.
In the optimum clinical trial, which was done, and we have pending results, where Dave Kanzari and Ajay were national PIs, and we contributed a ton of patients. That's a specific trial that looked at patients who were surgically turned down for PCI and underwent PCI for whatever reason. And I can tell you off the cuff that the outcomes in surgically turned down patients for whatever reason are a lot worse than patients who are not surgically turned down. So when patients get surgically turned down, they get turned down either for comorbidities like renal function, liver function, end-stage renal disease, etc. But there are also other reasons, for example, that make them surgically difficult, like a porcelain aorta, for example. The patient has normal renal function, normal liver function, normal LVEF, but they just technically cannot perform surgery. Even in those patients, for whatever reason, high-risk PCI carries higher procedural morbidity and mortality when you compare that to the STS predicted risk, and it's independent of their syntax score.
Sure.
So it's important to know that.
Yeah, that's those are great learning points, and I think this is what we do each time. Just to recapitulate, we did during the angiogram, the ETP was 18. Of course, we needed to make sure that this was done at the time of the procedure. The creatinine levels were normal, no overt bleeds. And of course, we had a discussion with the patient in a heart team approach. And so the plan today, this is a plan. Can I see the next slide? So the next, our plan was, of course, to take a bilateral access. So we had two, we went femoral because we knew that there's a lot of work that needed to be done in this case. One of the access was for, of course, the intervention, and the other was to keep for hemodynamic support if needed. We had a venous line also ready. We have an anesthetist at the head end who's there to support us in case there's a need to shift to to general anesthesia. So the plan here was to wire the LAD and, of course, make sure that we try and open up the in-stent restenosis of the circumflex first. Once we do that, and if you're able to achieve that, the intention was then to do a debulking with a cutting balloon. Now, the stent in the LAD, in the circumflex, seems to extend up to the proximal part of the circumflex, but does not seem to extend up to the ostium of the circumflex. And therefore, the intention was to do an OCT or an imaging in the LAD and look at the ostium of the circumflex. And of course, if you open up the circumflex, to image it from within the circumflex also. The calcium in the LAD is diffuse right from the proximal to the mid part also. And therefore, the thought was that we would probably put less stents the better. And with the mid LAD, we could get away with a physiology to tell us that we didn't need to do anything. We'd probably want to leave it without a stent there. We would have to have all the armament for dealing with calcium, including cutting balloons, high pressure balloons, and intravascular lithotripsy. The intention would be that if at all the ostium of the circumflex is clear, to avoid putting a stent there and get away with a DAB, and if at all, stent the left main from the LAD. And there's an OM, which is, or the ramus, or the high OM, which hopefully should not get compromised, but in case there's a compromise, we are ready to do a final triple kiss with two guides and three balloons. So this is what our plan was, and this is how we proceeded. So we've done some work till now, and can we go to the screen and show them? So please feel free to interrupt and ask us and guide us whenever you feel there's a need. So this was a seven French EBU that we started with. But again, go next. This is with a microcatheter and a Gaia's first. This did not seem to make any headway, and therefore I changed over to an Amplatz. Now what is important also is to understand that the left main is, the entire aorta is calcific. And when one is handling an Amplatz, one has to be very careful that one does not end up causing a dissection. And gentle guide handling is the key here. So we switched over to an Amplatz AL.7. And with the help of a Corsair and with a Conquest Pro, I managed to make up entry into the proximal cap. Quickly switched over from a Corsair Conquest Pro to a Gaia first. Next. This is the Conquest Pro, and the wire is now exchanged. And this is the Gaia first, through which we managed to enter into the distal true lumen. Next. So then we did a wire trap and removed the Conquest Pro, and then managed to, with a GuideZilla guided balloon, managed to dilate the proximal part of the stent. Next. So this is a small balloon, a 1.1 balloon. Next. Next. Yeah. So this is how the circumflex could be tackled. And then we did an imaging in the circumflex. So this is the wire exchange from the Gaia into a Grand Slam wire. And then a debulking was done with a Wolverine balloon. This was actually a non-compliant balloon first, and then a Wolverine balloon. So this was a 3-0 balloon. We went up to almost 18 atmospheres with this. There was some sort of spasm in the distal part, which did not give away despite use of a lot of intracoronary nitrates. And eventually, we could do an angiogram, OCT imaging in the circumflex. So my colleague Bikash would just show us the OCT images.
So we did that OCT, the circumflex, and you can see it's coming from the distal to the proximal part of the circumflex. And the idea was to see how the instant restenosis looks like, and also to look at the circumflex proximal part. And if you look at this, the stented area there, if you look at 1 o'clock and the 12 o'clock position, so there are some hyperplasia and proximal, and you see there is a circumferential intimal hyperplasia in this particular part, which was the most narrowed part of the circumflex. And this area was quite narrow. You can see that, and the area was about 1.49 millimeters square, with a lot of intimal hyperplasia was there. And they came again proximal, and you can see the proximal part, it's fairly 4.95 millimeters square at the ostium. And so
I think you've come to the left mean.
This is the ostium, also ostium. So it's about 4.9 and now coming to the left main. So the ostium was fairly well, free of disease. And the maximum area, the area which was stenosed inside the stent, there was a lot of interval hyperplasia in that particular area. And then back to after again.
Yeah, so then based on the IVUS, on the OCT images, we decided that there is still a lot of, despite our use of a Wolverine balloon, there still seems to be a lot of area which is still unexpanded, especially in the proximal part of the circumflex stent. And I don't know if, can they show us that the boost? No, okay. So we did a boost imaging, unfortunately I don't think so they can show it here, but the OM stent seems to be arising just after the origin of the circumflex stent. And next slide. We went ahead with a high pressure dilatation with an Opian balloon here. Okay, so then after this, I think we interrogated the LED with an OCT.
With OCT, yeah.
Bikash can go ahead and tell us.
So we are going to show you the OCT of the LED. Can you show the LED OCT, please?
So there was a problem with the OCT. The guide was sticking in that area of the turn there, and I had to do a gentle pre-dilatation there to get the guide down. So there was a calcium there that was holding up the OCT catheter.
So the LED was actually diseased, even further down, and the area was pretty small, and you can see there is a calcium in this particular picture. From 6 o'clock to 9 o'clock position, there was about there was a deep calcium there, and we're coming much more proximally. You can see some superficial calcium as well as the deep calcium in this OCT picture. Come proximal, Bala. And we are coming much more proximally. You can see there is about 180 degree arc of calcium. And in the most stenotic plaque part of the proximal part of the LED, the area was only 2.18 millimeters square with a nearly 180 degree deep calcium in that particular part. And you can see here that calcium is deep and it's spreading from 6 o'clock right up to 2 o'clock position. Up to 2 o'clock position, there is a calcium in the proximal part. So that was the condition of the LED before, then over to Aftab.
Yeah, so I think the LED is again, it shows a lot of arc of deep calcium, and this is a high calcium score, something that probably we would need a debulking with or calcium quantification with an intravascular lithotripsy. So that is what exactly we did. The reference vessel size in the mid LED was a 3O, and therefore we took a 3O balloon and did an intravascular IVL in the. Can you go to the next news? Yeah. Next. Okay, this will come back. Yeah. Okay. So just while we were waiting for the IVL, what we did is that we went and did a post dilatation in the proximal part of the circumflex stent. That area which had not really expanded despite the use of a Wolverine balloon. And this is a 3O Opian balloon, which is a high pressure balloon. I went to 40 atmospheres almost. And you can see that at the end of it, there was a little better opening of the stent, but it still seemed to show some amount of restenosis there. And this is what the final angiogram at the end really looked like. So this is the OPN balloon after the full expansion. Can you put it down? Yeah. So it seemed to have given away quite adequately. Next. And then while we were waiting for you, we went ahead and did an IVL in the LED. Next panel. So we delivered all the 80 shocks throughout the artery, starting from the midpoint, and then went ahead and treated the proximal LED, that was the tightest point, where we needed to give at least 30 pulses of energy there. So this is what we are finally at. So we've done a pre-dilatation of the circumflex ISR. We have done an IVL of the LED. And I'll just take a final shoot for you now to say where how we are paced position right now.
We did the OCT after that IVL as well, so you could show that as well.
Aryocaudal. So we did an OCT run post IVL also, and we could demonstrate the cracks in the calcium necessary for us to say that the OCT, the IVL really has done its job. So this is where we are right now. So what is your further suggestion for us? So the plan for us was that my plan would be to go and stent the LED. We would have to stent right from the mid part, probably take a 3-0 vessel, a 3-0 stent, since the reference vessel diameter distal is 2.8, and then proximally take a 3.5 and extend the stent onto the left main also. The circumflex is something that I don't wish to intend to stent given a choice, and probably I would want to do that with a DB if and leave it as it is. And that is how I would look at it. Any thoughts, any suggestions? I'm gonna give a stent for the LED.
338 or?
Dr. Srinivas, are you there with us?
Yes, sir, anything? Great job till now. You have opened a very complex retroverted circumflex, dominant circumflex. You've got it open. The whole issue was exactly where is the proximal stent in the circumflex. Yeah. So, because if you already have struts there, then probably a DEB may be a reasonable solution. Let's have Elvin and Ashish's view on this. Elvin, since you're watching this.
Yeah, I'm watching this. And the only comment I have to make, first of all, is when you start working, even if you're working for a CDO and you might need the lumen, you had a 7 French, I always put a wire in the LED. So whatever happens, might you have a dissection or something, especially that in this calcified areas, you have the LED protected because circumflex was already
a tube.
The second thing is that I see that there is a there is a stent in that marginal. And I see that after every dilation you're doing for the circumflex, that stent is being slowly scratched. So you have lost some lumen in the ostium of the marginal. So that area is more vital than the posterior area or the posterior basal area of the ventricle. What that marginal is going through is to the posterolateral area, and that gives more to the heart pump function than the CTO itself. So I will make sure that you don't damage that, and that also keeps you off from putting another stent, so it'll make two struts of stents before that ostium of that marginal, or if you call it a ramus intermedius. And that's why I will also be more in favor of doing that for the CDO.
So would you like to consider optimizing in both the vessels with maybe a kissing DEB or maybe one DEB and a non-compliant?
I will do that kissing eventually before starting to work in the LED, because otherwise it will be too late for that.
Yeah.
So, Anil, can I ask a question?
Please.
Yeah, so you opened the CTO now. And now the DEB would be a better choice, or putting in another stent would be a better choice because this is a CTO?
I don't think having a CTO or not having a CTO is all that important. What is important is How much of the major vessels are you likely to jail with another stent? Secondly, we already know that the performance which has been here, I don't think there's any head-to-head comparison data which tells us that a stent is better than a DEB, or DEB is better than a stent. So it's really a judgment call, and if you've already got stent struts there, then maybe, for example, in Keithi's case, I would have been very happy after the result was obtained that you had eliminated the neointimal hyperplasia, you got everything evened out, and there was no dissection, nothing left to be attacked with a stent to finish with a DEB. We know that it's still a technology in evolution, but if we have faith in it, then we should subscribe to it. This is probably a good reason, especially in a bifurcation point, and a point which Elvin made, I also realized that we should not compromise that large ramus. So maybe doing a kissing balloon, optimizing the two vessels, and then going ahead and doing the LED. And even at the end of the procedure, you're still not confident of the result of the circumflex, then you can always come back.
There is also distal to the circumflex stent, the previous circumflex stent, there is a dissection now, so this might be sealed. So a stent in the distal circumflex that it just opened could be necessary.
My point, Kanil, is the circumflex stent coming up to the
That's where the imaging, that's what he asked after. What are the imaging? What has it told us about where that circumflex stent is coming
from
up?
Pardon, I didn't get you again. Can you tell me again? Ask me again?
So after,
yeah, but
how far
can
is
tell
that
us circumflex
stent from the left main?
Yeah, so angiographically, unfortunately, we cannot really show you the images here. We did a stent boost, which becomes an easier method for us to know where the stent is landing. So the obtuse marginal branch, or the ramus, as you may call it, in fact, starts just after the OM, the stent in the circumflex. So it's something like a TN protrusion that has been done in the circumflex OM. And the circumflex stent does not seem to extend up to the ostium, at least on the OCT. So there's an area which is sort of disease-free between the proximal part of the circumflex stent and the left main.
So have you damaged it by any chance? Could you have hurt it by your balloon dilatation and aggressive with an OPN at 40?
Yeah, so we've been very careful to stay. So we've been very careful to stay within the stent.
Point. I mean, you're done.
So I read your point. Repeating your point in a different way.
That's what I said. We've been very careful to stay within the stent and not come onto the proximal part. So this is something that I've been very careful with.
Okay.
Wait.
Okay.
What I'm going to try to do now, so I've stented the mid part of the circumflex, mid part of the LED, and the intention now is to wire protect the OM1, because I agree that that's a major artery, and the last thing, that's the only flowing artery that we had earlier, and the only, it'll be a disaster if we manage to lose it or really cause a stent occlusion there or compression there. The last angiogram that was done with the circumflex did not seem to show any major problem there. But that's the precise reason why we kept a double guide there. And one has to be careful with this porcelain aorta to make sure that one does not really cause any problem there.
But why, after, why the double guide? Because you want to use a ping pong for possible pressing? What is it? Why are you taking a second guide?
Yes. So we can, of course, wire it within the 7 French. You can get 3 wires for sure. That's not an issue. But in case we end up doing a final kissing with 3 balloons with 1 7 French sometimes becomes very tight and maybe become a little bit difficult. And therefore, the intention is to use 2 balloons in 1 and probably do a kissing with...
Probably a ping pong guide.
Ping pong guide technique.
Are you going to stent it from the left main into the LED? Because there's a lot of dissection of the ostium.
Yes, the LED is going to be stented. LED. Yeah, the left main is going to get a stent of this into the LED.
Tom, I think you can decide finally what you are going to do and tell us. Because we're nearing the time, then we can come back and give you the final pictures later.
Sure. So the plan, therefore, is to wire all the 3 arteries. So we already have wire in 2. We're going to wire the obtuse marginal branch also. The next thing that I would probably plan to do is to do a DEB in the mid part of the circumflex beyond the stent. So as I think we've looked at the OCT, there are some flaps there which have been created by a gentle balloon dilatation. but I'm not very keen on putting a long stent there because the proximal stent inflow has already been affected, and putting a long stent there is not going to really give us a good outcome. The flaps that I see in the mid part of the circumflex are non-flow limiting, and therefore I'd probably just do a DB there. This is the final result in the circumflex. I wonder if you can see it there. So the mid part beyond the stent of circumflex will get a DB. My proximal part of the circumflex, again, I'm very, very keen to just do a DB and leave it rather than putting a stent there. And eventually, I'm going to do a final kissing with a DB.
I think after most of us feel that distal to the stent in the circumflex where there is a visible dissection which was actually flow limiting it at one point in the PCI, you should put in a stent rather than a DEB. The proximal, we leave it to your judgment.
Yeah, but
what do you say, Alvin? You agree?
Yeah, actually, wherever the...
Yeah, that's what I wanted to say. It's exactly that.
Yeah.
I think let him work in peace, sir. You had Ajay's presentation.
Yeah, Ajay, we actually messed up Ajay's presentation because he went to the cases and got excited. So Ajay's got a very, very important talk.
Yeah, so we'll work and we'll get back to you later on then. Once
yeah, okay. Sure, after. Great case, by the way.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so what we have done by after you left us is that we reassessed the circumflex OCT, and well, we do agree that there is a lot of dissection in the mid part of the stent of the circumflex post stent. So we have stented that area of the circumflex with a balloon with a stent there, and this is the result in the mid part of the circumflex after the stent. The proximal LED, you can see that there is a dissection caused by the IVL, and we need to stent that also. So I just wire protected the OM with another guide there, and this is the stent from the left LED to the left main that goes in there. So it's a 3-0 distally and a 4 proximally. And the fourth stent is now being deployed. We've done a pot with a 5-0 balloon. So this is a 5-8 pot that is done in the left main. And now I've just recrossed into the OM through the circumflex and the left main stent, and managed to secure that. So this is through the other guide that I've had there. And this is where I am right now. Now the problem is the ostium circumflex. I still think that I would probably leave it with a DB rather than putting a stent there, because with already two layers of stent, putting one more stent is really going to compromise the large ramus there, and that's not something that I want to do. So my plan would be to just do a DEB in the proximal part of the circumflex and leave this with a final kiss, where there's going to be, it's probably going to be a triple kiss with the two guides and the three wires there.
Okay, Aftab, great case, and thanks for showing it and complete it carefully, and hope everything goes well. Thank
sure,
you.
Sure.
We have sleep because Dimitri and all other officers are waiting, and again, further live tests.
Sure.
Namaste. I am Dr. A. Srinivas Kumar, Senior Consultant Cardiologist, Director of Cardiology and Clinical Research, Apollo Hospitals, Hyderabad. Greetings to you from FACTS Foundation and TCT India South Asia 2021. This video brings to you the live case learnings regarding the case just you watched, regarding the calcific multivessel disease, which was effectively tackled by the help of OCT imaging as well as bed preparation by IVL balloon followed by stenting. This was done by Dr. Aftab Khan from Apollo Hospitals, Kolkata. What we have learned in this case was initially after the assessment of the left dominant circulation as well as the LAD, RCA was non-dominant. The LCX was occluded in the mid segment after the stent. And the ramus stented portion was okay, and LAD had a lesion, ostial and the mid segment lesions were there, and all the calcium was very well seen. And initially the LCX CTO were reanalyzed using stiffer wires, the CTO wires, and then after that then it was dilated and the flow was established into distal LCX. It was also felt very important to protect the ramus as LAD while we do such procedures in the LCX, because the ramus and the OEMs or the vessels supply heart, which actually contributes to a lot of pumping and ejection of the heart. And in general, as a principle, whenever we are tackling the other vessels proximally, it is better to protect the other vessels by wire. This point was also highlighted by Dr. Alvin Kedi, who was moderating this session. Then after that, Dr. Aftab went on to do dilatation of mid and proximal LED, the long calcific lesions, and the IVL, how to use it and how it was effectively tackled to produce cracks in this calcium in these vessels were again shown very well. And then after the lesion bed preparation, then it was stented, both the mid and the left main to LED stent was tackled, and finally the patient had a good result. And whether to do a drug eluting balloon versus repeat drug eluting stent in the, after the instant restenosis in a CTO distal stented segment in LCX was discussed. And then finally, because the patient had as evidence of some dissections distal to the stent, it was decided to stent that patient again with a repeated drug eluting stent. Then OCT usage and appearance of calcium all in a circular fashion, and then probably tackling it with IVL balloon, which produced crackles, and all were effectively very well demonstrated in this live case. So hope all of you like this live case learnings, and how the multivessel PCA, especially calcific lesions, were tackled with IVL followed by stent in this case. Thank you. Yours, Dr. A. Srinivas Kumar.